One morning, a kind of weird moment before you wake up, that sort of half an hour, you're lying dozing in bed. And it was quite early in the morning. I remember kind of giving Richard a call and kind of waking him up and said, look, I've got to come over to yours, I've got this thing. Going in there and sort of, I've got this song. Film star, propping up the bar, driving in the car, it looks so easy. And he was sort of sitting there going, and kind of like just threading this guitar part around my little simple chant thing. But it was lovely the way we wrote that. There was something kind of spontaneous about that. That was exactly what I wanted to tap into with the realignment of the power structure within the band.
Yeah, that's how we wrote it. It was just that. That was when I realised that it was going to be so different to the last record, like unrecognisable as the same band. You know?
Yeah. When we kind of did that, I was like, wow, this is, yeah, we've got something here.
There's lots of vocals on this song. Brett really got into multi-tracking his voice, coming out with harmony parts. Brett is very knowledgeable about the sound of his voice. And his tuning as well is spot on. And some of the voices, when you solo them, sound a bit odd, but the composite result is perfect.
It's impossible to say.
And it'll be double track, I'm sure.
To believe in, it's impossible to say.
Okay, and then we got an ooh. Ooh. And then when he gets to the end here.
Change your name, wash your brain, play the game again. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They all go unison for the yeah, yeahs, which is just such a nice effect. It just makes that yeah, yeah, yeah leap out of the track.
The one that I like the most because I can connect to it, it's Film Star. And when I realised that yesterday, it bugged me a little because it was Brett and Nick Knight who ganged up on me to say that I should be on the cover. You know, I'd imagined it might be some sort of, like, washed-up version of John Hurt or something. I was initially quite offended. They both cast me as, like, the washed-up guy.
It's like a kind of cartoon song, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? It's sort of like all the colours are sort of turned up, sort of ultra...
Yeah.
Vivid, yeah, aren't they? But then again, I think coming up is like a cartoon album.
Ed's role in the album was amazing. And coming up wouldn't have sounded anything like it did without Ed, and it wouldn't have even had the same songs in it. Ed sits on a bit of that producer spectrum, which is very much about kind of like songcraft. And that's his genius. He kind of gets in there and he very, very honestly tells you whether he thinks the songs are any good or a load of rubbish. It can be crushing at times. He'll kind of like say, no, rubbish, no good, to a song that you've been working on for months and months and months.
The sound isn't right. I think the sound perhaps isn't right because the part isn't right.
A bad producer says, I love this new material of yours, I can't wait to record it. But what Ed does is say, OK, this is a good start. Now throw away three quarters of it. Let's start again at the bit that I like and keep this bit, throw away that. Let's re-engineer that. And really gets into the DNA of the writing of the song. And he's really an important part of what we do.
So, welcome to the world of Suede, viewers. This is what it's like, making records.
Your camera's just playing up to the video camera.
I can't.
I was a latecomer to this record in the sense that they actually actively tried to find somebody else to make the record. After we'd finished Dog My Star, kind of understandably, really, everybody wanted to turn the page.
Just, you know, the whole kind of thing about kind of doing things differently and, you know, it being a new chapter and a new band and everything.
And I did send music to a couple of producers, but none of it really stuck, none of it really felt correct.
Saul would keep coming around my house and playing me demos, and I'd be like, oh, God, these are good demos. Yeah, who's doing the record? Who's doing the record?
I'd said to Ed, what do you think? What do you want to do?
I just said, look, the kind of record you should make is a pop record, this should be steak and chips. This should be something very straightforward. And it was like, well, funny you should say that. These are the songs we got. And they were all pretty much like that. Short and sweet and poppy. And so it just seems silly not to get on and do it.
He was on a personal mission. He had this idea, which I think came from him, not from us, that every track should be a single, which led us down some ridiculous back alleys as he tried to turn kind of By the Sea into a single.
She can walk out anytime, anytime she wants to walk out. That's fine.
In fact, is it not the first thing that you played with us?
That was about the only thing that I actually had to learn, yeah. I got given a tape and then the next day I had to pop down to the rehearsal.
Neil's arrival was definitely unexpected, definitely unusual.
They augment another member who happened to be Simon's cousin. And the only reason that he ended up in the band is because he turned up at the studio and he wanted to borrow a suit or something.
I was living in Crouch End, just up the road from where Suede were doing demos at the Church Studios, and I went to borrow a suit off Simon to go to an interview in Soho.
I don't know, did you just suddenly start playing the piano or something, or the drums? You were playing on the drums for a while, I think, and then everyone turned up. And I think, I don't know, I think you just literally just slipped into being in Suede.
He didn't turn up saying, I want to play piano along to what you're doing. It just, that sort of happened naturally.
He's a very accomplished musician and he found it very difficult to play the piano the way we wanted him to play the piano. See, that's a proper pianist. And then we say, no, we don't want to play like that.
He tried to get me to play it like All Tomorrow's Parties. A Velvet Underground kind of vibe, which would have been much more like.
Adding a kind of pulse and a sort of sense of harmony.
So I tried for a few hours to make that work.
He found it very hard to do.
Well, it was the first time anybody had told me what to play at the piano, and it was like, no, you're not doing it right. Give me something different. So he tried to get me to play as if I was a looping sampler.
And he plays on top of it a sort of slightly offbeat rhythm. And the two together. The basic drive. And then on top of that, he put these little keyboard bits. What a great sound. What on earth did we do that with? I could listen to that all day.
Then as soon as we played it live again, I just went straight back to the... Lesson not learned.
So I'd written By the Sea and Lazy before Richard had joined, probably back in 1993, and Lazy actually did become a single.
Top 10 single. Another one.
Different chord there.
Bells and bells and their mums and their friends, and everyone just wants to be loved.
There you go. We don't need to hear much more of that, do we? I think. But it's a very different song. It's kind of like the guitar part that you put on. It suddenly became, like a band song.
Thank you.
It was one of the ones that needed guitar, wasn't it? It needed-
yeah.